If, like me, you watched Netflix's The Queen's Gambit in 2020 and are now curious about the higher end and more competitive side of chess, and also what a Queen's Gambit actually is, then this is the video for you. Let's step up from small talk on chess. Hi everyone, my name is David De La Cruz and welcome to Medium Talk. If your friends, your colleagues, or your clients have picked up chess in the last year or are longtime players, this Medium Talk video is about helping you better understand what more advanced and competitive chess looks like. The aim is so that you can have a more interesting conversation with a chess lover, not to pretend that you're a grandmaster yourself. That said, let's get into it. First of all, in case you are unfamiliar, chess is a two-player board game played for hundreds of years at all levels, from kids playing casually to professionals playing at international tournaments. Each player has 16 pieces, a king, a queen, two rooks, two knights, two bishops, and eight pawns. Each piece can move in different ways, with the queen the most powerful and the pawn the least. The player with white pieces starts, and then players take turns moving pieces to gain a strategic advantage or capture opposing pieces. The objective is to checkmate the opposing king by placing it in a position where capture is unavoidable. The game can also end by a player resigning, running out of time, or in some cases a draw or stalemate. Play is broken up into three main stages. Firstly, the opening. In the opening stage, the players are concerned with developing their pieces. This means positioning your pieces in strategically important areas of the board, often in the center, where you can control the most territory. In this stage, players often play sets of moves called openings, which have names like the Ruy Lopez, Sicilian Defense, etc. The Queen's Gambit, which is named in the show, is one of the oldest openings, where white appears to sacrifice the pawn in the C file in order to gain control of the center. Next, the middle game. During this stage, play is a lot more fluid, with less defined plays and many possibilities, depending on how the game develops. There are several tactics that you can deploy to capture pieces and improve your position, like double attacks, pins, or fork moves, until you reach the end game. There's no defined transition between middle and end game, but the end game is generally when only the king and a few other pieces remain. In this stage, having extra pawns or the ability to promote a pawn will win you the game. Here, the king comes into play to protect the pawns, or to force the opponent to make unwanted moves. The game then ends when the opponent is unable to move or has lost all their pieces. The first mentions of chess are from 7th century India. From there, the game spread to Persia, where it got the name Shah, which eventually evolved to chess in English. It also spread east to Asia along the Silk Road. In Europe in the Middle Ages, the game took on its modern form, despite the church being against games in general. From the 1500s to the 1800s, there was a lot of study of chess and a shift to a more strategic and analytical style of play. The late 19th century saw the advent of international competitions, and during the Cold War, a period of Soviet dominance, starting with Mikhail Botvinnik in 1948. Because of chess's military strategy metaphors, the Soviets devoted a lot of resources to chess, as they saw it as a show of superiority. During this period, depicted in the Queen's Gambit show, American Bobby Fischer was the only non-Soviet world champ until the end of the USSR. Since 1990, we've seen the rise of chess computers. The first computer victory over a sitting grandmaster coming in 1997 when IBM's Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov. International competitions happen every year, with the current world champion being the Norwegian Magnus Carlsen. Tournaments typically take place locally, nationally, and regionally, culminating with the World Championship, which takes place every 2 years. However, the competitive chess circuit still has struggles with gender diversity. Only 11% of ranked players and 2% of grandmasters are female. Now, 2020 has been an absolutely bumper year for chess, as firstly, the pandemic forced people to look for indoor hobbies, and then Netflix's The Queen's Gambit ignited even more interest in chess, especially online, with Bloomberg reporting that online chess matches have doubled in the last 12 months. Many competitive players, including American Grandmaster Hikaru Nakamura, have started streaming their play on Twitch. It's hoped that these changes will attract new participation in chess, especially amongst girls. Big gaming companies are now also sponsoring top chess players, and this may be how chess continues in the future. Well, I hope this little introduction into the higher ends of chess has been helpful for you. If you are interested in learning more about chess, I can recommend chess.com on YouTube. They do some really good explainer videos. And also chess.com is the largest online portal for playing chess, either against bots or against human competitors. If you want to learn more about the world of competitive chess, there's a lady called Anna_chess. She streams on Twitch and also on YouTube. She gives some really good overviews of what's happening in the world of competitive chess. And also, before I mentioned Grandmaster Hikaru, he's another great person that streams on Twitch and explains a lot of the theory behind chess. So check those channels out. Hope you enjoyed learning a little bit more about chess. Do let me know in the comments what kind of other topics you would like me to cover in the future. And I'll see you in the next one. Thanks, guys.